Hey, everybody. Good to be with you. Look at all the folks who knew that the Bears game starts at 3. Well, hey, I just want to say on behalf of Pastor Tommy, who's down in Aurora bringing the word to the people at that campus, and Jennifer and the entire Elgin ministry team, we just really love you guys and count it an incredible privilege to be able to serve you in the way that we do. So I don't get this opportunity too often, and I just was like, I got to just make sure that you all know that we really love you very much and thank God for you. Well, hey, we're about to jump into God's word. We've got a great message. Why don't we pray, and then we'll get after it. Father, thank you so much for the privilege that we have today to be able to worship you in spirit and truth. And so much of what we've done is for sure to exalt the name of Jesus Christ. It's also been a time to just surrender and to yield and to say, here, Lord, here's our heart. And so, God, as we open up your word, your word says that it will never return void. And so plant in us the seeds of truth that you would want us to receive today so that then out of our hearts would grow the fruits that show that we are growing into people who are more like Jesus. We love you. We commit this time to you. I'm not here to preach myself, but I'm simply a servant. And so fill me with your spirit. Be in this place, God. Move in a way where it's just so evident that you are here. We love you, and we pray this all in your name, Jesus. Amen. Hey, did you hear about that lady in New York at the zoo in the Bronx earlier this month? She went up to the lion's den. Did you hear about this? And she went to the fence, and she found a way around and then into and came face to face with a full-grown lion. And she actually lived to tell about it. I think she also lived to be able to get a big fat ticket for trespassing. But as people watched the video of her taunting this king of the jungle, they were mystified. They were horrified. Why was that? Because it's just understood that there are certain places where you just don't trespass, like lion's dens, snake pits, or that secret base out in New Mexico, I think it is, with all the UFOs, Area 51, right? Okay. But too often, we mistakenly apply that same no trespassing rule to Jesus, which leads us to settle for peering at Jesus from a distance rather than encountering Jesus. But I would imagine that there are many of you here today and you're coming burdened with some kind of uncertainty or emptiness, or you have a longing for purpose. And the solutions that the world is offering to you, they are not cutting it. And so as we press on into this wonderful series that we're in, where we're going verse by verse through the book of Mark, the series called Just Jesus, Come and See, you're going to see that Jesus is offering you an invitation. It's an invitation to make a move from just simply knowing about Jesus to actually knowing him and experiencing him personally and powerfully. The invitation that he's giving to you today, and it's the title for our message, is come close. So turn in with your Bibles to Mark chapter 3. And as you're turning there, let's just take a quick look in the rearview mirror to get a refresher on what's just taken place. Simply put, Jesus, he's getting pressed. He's getting pressed by the religious leaders. And he's getting pressed by the swarm of people who have heard that he can heal anything. And so what does Jesus do as he's getting pressed? Let's pick up in Mark chapter 3, verse 7. Here we go. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the sea, And a great crowd followed him from Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem and Idumea and from beyond the Jordan and from around Tyre and Sidon. When the great crowd heard all that he was doing, they came to him. And he told his disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, lest they crush him. For he had healed many, so that all who had diseases pressed around him to touch him. And whenever the unclean spirit saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." And he strictly ordered them not to make him known. Now, it may surprise you, like it did me at first, that Jesus withdrew. But I want to assure you that this was in no way Jesus going off mission. Really smart Bible scholars have identified two possibilities as to why Jesus withdrew from where he had been preaching in the synagogue. The first is that, well, what were the Pharisees trying to do to Jesus just a few verses ago? They were planning his assassination, right? And so Jesus perhaps knew that in a small town like Capernaum, where there are lots of dark alleys, he could have been easy prey for their plan. But another option, and the one that I'm going to go with, is that Jesus, being God, he knew that a great crowd was coming to see him, and he knew that the confines of a small town wouldn't accommodate this great crowd that were coming to see him, and so he went to the shore where there was more space. Now, there's something really interesting that I learned about this great crowd that came to see Jesus, and I want to share it with you. I had some really smart friends help me put this together so that we could grasp the great lengths and efforts that the people went to come to see Jesus. So you'll see on the screen here that the people came from Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem and Idumea and beyond the Jordan and up to Tyre and Sidon. And here's the thing that you need to know. What my friends helped me to learn is that that land covers over 13,000 square miles. To put it in a frame of reference that would help you understand that even more, you can see on the screen that we've laid that space of land over the map of Illinois. And so it would be like going from Peoria up to the state line of Wisconsin and all the way over to the state line in Indiana, back down and over again. These people went to great lengths to see the Lord. And remember, there's no highways or hotels, there's no form-fitting sandals or camelbacks to have a steady stream of water to help you. Yet the people pushed through the distance and the discomfort because they had heard about all that Jesus was doing. But think about that. Word traveled in a time when there was no cable news. There was no Facebook Live. I know, hard to imagine there was ever such a time. Okay, but word was spreading like wildfire that there was a man who was healing the sick and the paralyzed and setting the demon-possessed free. There was no Walgreens or CVS, no urgent care or WebMD. This was their only hope. And so they came to Jesus just believing that if I could just reach him and touch him, that might be enough. And the way that Mark describes the scene with the people pressing in upon him, I wonder if it might be something like this familiar scene. Watch the screen.
Some brave volunteers among the British police elect to act with heroism above and beyond the call of duty and escort the Beatles to their car. There hasn't been this much excitement at the London airport since man learned to fly. So there you have the homecoming of the Beatles, the return of the heroes to their native land. They did what the Redcoats couldn't do in the American Revolution. They conquered the colonies.
I think some of us remember who the Beatles are, right? Okay. But unlike John and Paul and George and Ringo, who were trying to do what? Get away from the crowds. What we're seeing from the text is Jesus was welcoming them. And that leads to this first thought. Come close to Jesus because he wants to change you. Now, the people were coming to Jesus because they were desperate for what? physical healing, right? But notice in verse 9 that the instructions that Jesus gives to his disciples, it wasn't to set up a triage unit to be able to provide more healing. No, no. It was to give him a better platform in order to give to the people what they needed most, the gospel. And here's what that means then, that the healing wasn't the goal for Jesus. John wrote about this in his gospel. He said, "Truly, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these, the miracles, are written that you may believe," here it is, this is the purpose of the miracles, "that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in him." Amen. So Jesus' invitation to come close is so that he could change the part of you that matters most, your heart. The heart, it's the grand central station of you. And it's God's highest desire that your heart would swell with a yearning to do what you've done this morning, and that's to worship him. Increasingly so. But worship, you see, I want to be clear, it's not simply announcing like the demons did in verse 11 that Jesus is the Son of God. No, what they were doing was mockery. Jesus' invitation to change you is rooted in his outrageous plan to make worshipers out of rebels. Which begins when a person believes in their heart that Jesus is who he says he is, the Lord, and then embraces by faith forgiveness for their sin. But the reality is that this transformation from rebel to worshiper, it's a remodeling project and it takes time, amen? And Paul spoke about this in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18. "And we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image," the image of Christ, "from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit." Now this idea of transformation, it's all around us. And this week I found that it was in baby flamingos. Baby flamingos, let's see one on the screen. Yeah, they look a lot like their parents, except something's missing, right? The pink. That's because when they're born, their feathers are, as you can see, white or gray. But over time, they take on that same pink as their parents. But how? Well, I love this. You are what you eat. You are what you eat. And what the flamingos eat is shrimp and algae. And the pigments that are in those things are the same pigments that are in shrimp that turn them pink when they're cooked. And so just as the flamingos' process of change is fairly simple, you are what you eat, God's plan for changing you into a true worshiper is also simple, but it's, I'll be honest, it's not easy. It's simple because really God is just focused on changing one thing about you, and here it is, your desires. Your desires. Your desires, they're like a coin. On the one hand, okay, your desires move you to make right decisions, but then suddenly, on the other hand, they take you to do things you wouldn't dream of doing. It's that tension between the desires of the spirit and the desires of the flesh. David talked about desires in Psalm 73 when he said, "Besides God, I desire nothing on earth." But then James said in chapter 1 that our desires give birth to sin. So how do you get victory over your desires? Well, let's go back to the flamingo because we can learn from them. In the same way that the bird's feathers change over time because of what it eats, the time that you spend listening to God speak to you as you read his word, the time that you spend pouring out your heart to God in prayer, the time that you spend pouring into your relationships, the choices that you make that affect your character, those are all tools in the hand of your Redeemer to be able to change you, to transform you. Our small group ministry has a tool to help us with this, and it's called spiritual growth points. And it has three categories: spiritual, relational, and character. You can see them on the screen and get some examples of different ideas that will help you to grow, ways in which you can chase after to be able to grow in Christ. And when a plan is put together and you're encouraged and held accountable, then here's what happens. Instead of desires for pleasure, your desire is to be satisfied by God. Instead of desires for more for you, you now desire to give. Instead of desires that are about your plans, your ways, now you have a desire to serve. Instead of desires for self, you're growing in your desire to adore Jesus. I think this is what David meant when he said that those who look to the Lord will become radiant. They'll be transformed. And I just want to say that as I look out around this room and look at people who I know, who I've known for some for a short time, many for a long time, I just want to say that I see you doing this. And I see Christ changing you. Well, eventually Jesus' time with the great crowd came to an end. But another invitation to come close is waiting for us to discover. So let's go back in the text, starting in verse 13. Let's read. And he went up on the mountain, and he called to him those whom he desired, and they came to him. And he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him, and he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. Well, after a long day, doing a lot of hard work with a lot of demanding people, don't we all just want a little me time? Right? And it would look like that's where Jesus is headed as he goes up the mountain, but then he stops and he turns and he calls out 12 men to come be with him. Which brings us to this next lesson. Come close to Jesus because he wants to have a relationship with you. Now, it's important. I want to acknowledge the tone that Jesus must have had when he called the disciples to be with him. In the original language, the word used here indicates that Jesus, he invited them. He wanted to be with them. And so just imagine for a moment that in a crowd, maybe like this, Jesus suddenly calls, Peter, James, John. Can you imagine what it was like for them to hear the Son of God, the one who spoke creation into existence, now it's calling their name to come be with him? This motley crew of 12 men would spend 3 years being with Jesus, which explains why they became the men who, when we read about them in the book of Acts, it says that when the people saw their boldness and perceived that they were uneducated common men, the people were astonished. Why? Because they recognized that these men, they'd been with Jesus. Well, my relationship with Jesus started way, way, way back in 1985 at a summer camp when I heard a man share with great love and probably a whole lot of patience with a room full of teenagers that God loved us. He loved us so much that he sent his son to pay the price that we deserve, that I should pay for the sin that I had committed, and if I would turn by faith and embrace Jesus for forgiveness, I would be saved and I would be adopted into his family. And I did that. I came to Jesus and embraced him by faith, and he became my Savior. But I came to Jesus for another reason too. I wanted to make the varsity soccer team. And I did. But instead of that being a catalyst to our relationship, I felt obligated. I had to pay him back. I had no concept of grace. And so for the next several years, what I would do is I would carry my Bible around because, well, that's what Christians do, right? But I didn't read it. And I didn't date girls who drink or chew. You know what I'm saying? And here's the thing. My relationship with Jesus was lifeless. And it wasn't until I graduated from college and began to work and got to a place of being totally desperate that I finally came to Jesus to have with him what he had always been willing to have with me, which was a relationship. Now, it may be that some of you grew up in a home with an absent or irritated parent, or you grew up in a religious, do-as-you're-told environment, or maybe you've rebelled with the best of rebels. But instead of looking at Jesus as one who welcomes you, you think that Jesus looks at you like you're an inconvenience. And then there are others of you who would say, no. I get this whole Jesus is approachable thing. Okay, can I just challenge you with that for a moment? Because I'm glad that that is probably your spoken theology, what you say you believe about God. But what would your lived theology reveal that you really believe? So some questions. When was the last time that you woke up and you just couldn't wait to be with Jesus? When was the last time that you were reading his word and you just felt like he was speaking to you? When was the last time that you cried out to the Lord like the psalmists, real, raw, and reverent? How do you have a relationship with Jesus like this? Well, start here. Make sure that your view of God is right. A.W. Tozer said that the most important thing about a person is what comes to mind when they think about God. And then I like what another author followed up with, Brendan Manning, said that the next most important thing is what you think comes to mind. Excuse me, let me say that again. The next most important thing is what you think comes to God's mind when he thinks about you. And I think it would be time well spent if we went to the spiritual optometrist this week and asked him to do a vision check in these areas. And when you find, like I have, that your vision of God needs to be renewed, then can I invite you to do something? Go for a walk with Jesus. Go to the Psalms and walk with the Lord in a chapter like Psalm 139, where it says that your good shepherd goes out before you, he comes behind you, and he, in a way that only he can, lays his tender hand upon you. Or go to Psalm 44, which gives us the permission to be real with God and raw with God, but also reverent with God. But I want to be careful here, because I don't want to give you the impression that there's some kind of incubation period where you can just walk with Jesus while everyone else does the work. Because if you look back in the passage, you'll see that Jesus invited the disciples to not only be with him, but to send them. And that leads to our final point. Come close to Jesus because he wants to send you. Mark is about to list for us the roster of Jesus's disciples, his apostles. And if this were happening in 2019, I would imagine the news channels would be going up in arms over the choices that Jesus has made. Maybe it would be something like this. This just in. Jesus, he's announced his 12 disciples, and you're not gonna believe who he chose. Peter, a fisherman by trade, but really impulsive. James and John, AKA sons of thunder, also fishermen with explosive tempers. You can see the slide on the screen there of, these are exact replicas of the disciples, by the way. Kidding, of course. And then we have Andrew, Peter's brother, but not a real go-getter. Philip, warm-hearted, but probably lacks vision to get things done. Bartholomew, real head-scratcher here, the only one of the 12 with royalty in his veins. Matthew, a tax collector by trade. Wait, don't Jews hate tax collectors? All right. Moving on. Thomas, a courageous man, but a real doubter. James, son of Alphaeus. We think he might be Matthew's brother. So I wonder, maybe these two will team up to write a book about their time with Jesus. Thaddeus and Simon the Zealot, intense Jewish nationalists. And then Judas Iscariot, the would-be treasurer, and some are already questioning his loyalty. The reality is, okay, that none of these men were trained to be ministers. None of these men had significant leadership experience. If it was us, if it was up to us, looking on the outward appearance, we would go to Jesus and say, are you sure about that? But aren't you glad that God doesn't look on the outward appearance? He looks on the heart. And he did. And he invited these men to come close, that he might send them out. Last week, you may recall that I shared a story about a brother in our church. I like to say that he sees himself as a Christian, cleverly disguised as a policeman. And late last week, he was manning his radar gun, and all of a sudden, a car sped by doing 95 in a 45. And so a few days after my friend had issued this guy a well-deserved speeding ticket, that man's brother came to the police station to say, thank you. You saved my brother's life. He was heading toward running his car into a tree. And at that point, this Christian policeman had a choice. Would he just think, hey, I'm just a policeman. Caring, counseling that guy, that's what the professionals do. We'll let the pastors do that. Or would he see himself as a sent one? Well, tonight, this friend, this man from our church, he has an appointment to meet with this young man, to be able to begin to build the friendship that we're praying will turn into the relationship that will give him the opportunity to lead this young man to Jesus. That's right. That's right. Would you pray? Would you pray that God would move in that relationship? That's awesome. But here's the thing. What was the fire that burned in those disciples that would move them to go out into the world to share the gospel at great expense to their lives? What's stirring inside this brother from our church that he would say to this detour that God has put into his life, okay, here I am, send me. Well, here's what I think it is. It's because they've been gripped by the great love of God. And now they want to go out into the world to share that love with others. And so as you grow in love for God and for people, you will have the motive that you need to be sent. But what is God sending you to do? Well, first, he's sending you to go work for him, to work for Christ. Working for Christ is shouldering weekly kingdom responsibilities to help build the church. There's just a few of us here on staff. We need your help to be able to move this church forward for the glory of God. And so many of you are doing that already. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your selfless service for the church. And here's what I want you to do now. I want you to become contagious. I want you to talk about how God is working in you and through you and what you're doing for him so that others would want to join you in that good work. But if you're not yet working for Christ like you could, I just want to tell you right now, God has given you beautiful, powerful spiritual gifts and life experiences that I know because I've seen it happen time after time with hundreds and thousands of people in our church. It will make you a force for the kingdom. We have loads of ways and times for you to be able to work for Christ in this church, and we would love to help you do that. But not only is God sending you to work for Christ, he also is calling you to witness for Christ. Jesus said that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. And so let's start here. Let's begin by praying. Oh God, would you burden my heart? Would you put an ache in me for the lost? And would you draw the lost to yourself like you drew me to you? But eventually we need to move from just praying about it to actually going and doing it. And so may this be true of our church, that we would be people driven by a deep love for others that moves us to build relationships that one day through the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of prayer will give us the opportunity to humbly and boldly tell others about how awesome Jesus is. Amen? Well, as we start to bring this to a close, I want to tell you a story. Way back in 1990 when I was in college, that was a long time ago now, there was this contest that took place where every year students could write an essay about five people that they admired. And then the winner would be able to choose one of those five people to be able to actually go and spend the day with them. And so I entered, hoping that I'd win so that I could meet my number one, Greg LeMond. Now, before there was ever Lance Armstrong, there was Greg LeMond. He was the first American to win the Tour de France. And as it turned out, I won. Which meant that I was going to have to fly in a plane, rent a car, and then drive to the house of this world-famous superstar that I didn't know, and he didn't know me. But do you think that I was going to let any of that get in the way of me spending the day with this legend? Of course not. And I did, and it was awesome. And today, maybe you see yourself in one of the three areas that we've talked about. And I just want us to be a church where we're willing to do whatever it takes to be with Jesus, to draw near to Jesus, to come close to Jesus, praying that the Spirit of the living God would meet us right where we are. And so there's going to be some circles that are going to come up on the screen, and I want you to consider which one of those is the Lord saying, that's the one. And so first, is God calling you to respond, to come close, to be with him? Maybe you just need to be with Jesus once and for all. And to come to him today, in a moment, the band is going to begin to play and the front is going to be open. And would you come and tell Jesus, I just want to be with you. I know that you love me. You proved it on the cross. Please forgive me, Lord. I confess with my mouth that you are the Lord. Is Jesus inviting you to come close to be with him for salvation? Or maybe this is you. Maybe Jesus is inviting you to have that authentic, genuine relationship with him, to be in community with him. Maybe today you come forward to be able to say to Jesus, our relationship isn't what it should be. Lord, I want to have a deeper, wider relationship with you. Or maybe this last circle applies to you. You need to come close to Jesus because you just know, like you know, it's time. It's time for you to be sent. You've been given all the excuses for months and for years now, but today's the day. And so would you come today to say, Jesus, no more excuses. I'm coming close because I want to be sent. Send me, Lord. And when that happens, when you're with Jesus in a relationship with him, sent by him, then you can see what happens there in the middle. As the circles come together, I'm going to call that our sweet spot. And that's when all of this is working together, and that's what Jesus wants for us as church, that we would be living and relating and working with him and with each other in unity, bringing glory to God. And so I want to invite you now to stand. As our worship team begins to play the song, would you just respond to the invitation that Jesus is coming to you to come close, to be with him, to be in a relationship with him, to be sent by him. Don't wait. Come now. He's inviting you to come close. Come. Come.